Good thing we didn't have rain. We would have been squished in here. We had rain last event. Anybody here last event? It was pouring rain, so we covered up here and we closed it off here and we packed everybody here. So it worked out good. How many of you here for the first time? Look at that! Okay, and those of you who have been here all the time, we know who you are. They've heard all my jokes. My jokes are the same all the time. So these guys can laugh at my jokes, and you guys can say, that joke again! there's my laugh there, my soundtrack. There you go. There you go. Very good. So, anybody do anything exciting this last weekend? Anything in the last week? Anybody see a good movie? No? Superman vs. Batman? First Batman, was that good? No? It was terrible?
The bus was funny.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
Oh, very good. Very good. Anyway, today is a special day that we celebrate the life and achievements of one of our own. Even you. No. He is chief instructor of the Wing Chun Temple in Long Beach. He's one of the biggest advocates for the spread of Wing Chun on the West Coast. He's a very good dresser, right?
He's a pretty good dresser.
That's pretty good, yeah. In his younger days, he was a Bruce Lee lookalike. Yeah, did you see that on Facebook, that picture of him that looks like Bruce Lee? I thought it was Bruce Lee, but, you know. And he's one of the nicest and most respectable and humble person you ever meet. Today, April 23rd in the year 2016, his friends and students, martial arts peers, his students are here, right? There's the students. Very good. Nice of you to come dressed. Very classy. Very classy. Yeah. In case there's any trouble, guys, we got to throw you out. Today we gather to celebrate the life of one of the most unique and inspiring individuals in our lifetime. Today is Clark Tang Day! Clark Tang Day is the time the museum sets aside to honor someone unique from the martial arts community. Someone who has made an impact on other people's lives. It has been noted to me on many occasions when someone passes away and we talk about them, they're never gonna hear us. So while they're alive, this is that time, this is opportunity to say thank you for teaching us, for being part of our lives. So making a difference in our lives. So a brief history of the museum. We began in 1999. We were a traveling exhibit. We traveled all over the country. We started with a 10 by 10 square booth, and we moved up to a 1,000 square booth, and we were traveling all over in truck, and everybody was paying for us, which was thankful to move the truck and get the exhibit there. We were at SeaWorld, we were in New York, we've been in Las Vegas, you name it, we've had this huge, big place that we took. Very tiring. We did about once, twice a month, so it was took a big toll for about 4 years. We moved to Santa Clarita in 2006. We opened in Santa Clarita. We were there for 1 year, and we moved out of there and relocated here in 2010. So we've been here, this is our fifth year in this location, 17th year overall since the museum started. Yay! Can you believe we're still here? He said it wouldn't last. No, no. You know, we had planned all this time for the museum. We had planned it since the 80s for the museum, but the public wasn't ready for it. The internet wasn't ready. It was still in its infant stage in the early 90s, barely getting there. It was too hard to advertise the place anywhere else. So we waited about 10 years till we gathered information, gathered stuff, got everything set up, did testing. We tested it with going to different places, what people liked, what they enjoyed, their attention span, type size, size of picture, what would they look at for a long time, what would they ignore. So we tested all this out to make sure there was going to be enough interest in the museum. There's no reason to start the museum if we weren't going to have enough interest to support it. So that's what we did. We took it along the road and tested it and tested it. And once we were made sure that people were going to support it, I had to make sure I had the knowledge to do it. So going to marketing courses and design and museum production and all that, and getting all that, getting it ready to launch in 1999. So we took great care to make sure the museum will last. So long after I'm gone, the museum is going to continue on for the next hundreds of years. So that's our goal, and it's planned to last that way. So they'll forget us all, right? No. They'll remember us all.
And they see our big statue in front, right?
No. So before, again, I'd like to acknowledge some of our members, our honor awards recipients and Hall of Famers. Hall of Famer, Mr. Carl the Tatan. Yeah. And then our honor awards people is Mr. Robert Dio. Yeah. Mr. Chuck Yarbrough, right? Chuck Yarbrough, right? Yeah. Was it? There you go. The Reed, right? There you go. Mr. Nick Palma. Nick Palma is one of the original Ninja Turtles.
Yeah.
The original Ninja Turtles. He's the man. And is that everybody? I can't remember if everybody's here. But if I forget you, that's okay. So here's what we're going to do today. We'll do our introduction, what I'm doing now. We'll do a presentation with the museum certificate designed by Ed Parker. It's very cool. We'll do our first video collage on Clark Tang. We'll read his biography. We'll play our second video, and we'll toast him a little bit. Not roast, nice. Nice. I can't stand those roasts where they insult you. How terrible is that? People insulting you. And then we'll give all you guys an opportunity to come here on stage and say a few words about Clark. Don't be shy. Everybody will come up at each time. No, I'm just kidding. Little bit of time will come up, and then we'll bring up the man himself. And it'll take how many hours?
One.
4 hours. No, it's not going to take 4 hours. See, that's my joke. You're supposed to laugh because you never heard that before. Like my Taco Bell joke, right? You know the best Mexican food, right?
Taco Bell.
Taco Bell. There you go.
Best Chinese
food.
Panda Express.
And orange chicken. Nobody makes orange chicken like Panda. I went to every Chinese restaurant in Chinatown. Nobody makes orange chicken like Panda Express, right? Right? Panda, you should give me a residual. Okay, so let's begin. The Martial Arts History Museum brings a form of validity to the martial arts. Not just for verification's sake, but it shows the world that the martial arts has played a key role in American history. It is a way of letting others know the impact of our pioneers, our significant achievers, our history makers, and our champions made on the world. It is without a doubt, Clark Tang loves Wing Chun, right? They say that manager Tommy Lasorda from the Dodgers, if you cut him, he would bleed Dodger blue. If Wing Chun had a color, that's what he would bleed, right? He loves Wing Chun, right? What is Clark's favorite subject to talk about? Wing Chun! There you go. If there was a food named Wing Chun, he would order it all the time. Now, there's a girl named Wing Chun. There you go. Well, a couple hundred years ago. So. Now, many people study Wing Chun. Many become experts, have become experts in the art, but only a few will make it their mission to reinvigorate the art, bring new awareness to its benefits. And although the doors of Wing Chun were already open before him, Clark Tang pushed it open much wider. Therefore, it is with great pride that the Martial Arts History Museum is proud to present Clark Tang with the official museum certificate designed by Mr. Ed Parker. So I'm going to have him come up here, and we're going to do a little picture opportunity. There we go. And let's do that. There we go. Isn't this cool? So Mr. Tang, come on up here. Because of his devotion to the martial arts, his role as an inspirational leader to his students and his peers, and his effort to promote the Chinese art of Wing Chun Kung Fu
to the world and the many benefits it has to offer, the Martial Arts History Museum is proud to recognize today as Clark Tang Day. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I got a pose here first. There we go. Hold it right there. How you guys doing? Okay, we're gonna shift a little bit. There we go. We're modeling here. Look at that. How you guys doing? Good.
Hey, so nice. There you go.
There you go. There you go.
What do you expect? I'm just a Chinese guy.
That's Wing Chun.
Back this way.
Okay.
Say a few.
Okay. Could you raise your hand? Who's the first time here?
Good.
I'll tell you what. There's no Clark Tang Day. It's your day because it's your first day. At a museum, you break it through. So this museum opened for many years. Even myself, as a martial artist and love martial art, it's very hard to find a time here. Until one day, I just pop it in out of blue, and here we go. You know, Master Masuda, you honor a lot of people. But matter of fact, him, Master Sao, I have great respect for him. Because he has a bigger picture. Imagine, this is only a dream for all martial artists, bring all martial artists together. No one has done it like him, bringing martial artists. Even since they are roof walkers, can you imagine that? It's very hard to make her come out. But so anyway, for that, I really honor you. Thank you.
Wing Chun, Yip Man, Wong Long, Wing Chun. We'll be right back.
let's take a moment and talk about the biography of Clark Tang. It was at the young age of 5 or 6 years old when he went to a Chinese theater and saw Shaw Brothers Kung Fu movie starring T Lung. Anybody know who T Lung is? Right? Anybody know T Lung? Fu Shang? Right? Anybody know Fu Shang? Check my tie? David Carradine? We're old, aren't we? Those are the best, though. Right? Kung Fu movies? They were the best. We used to go to them when they came out in Chinatown. I went to, you know, what?
The black and white ones, the Wong Fei Hung movies.
Oh, the old ones. I went to 2 years of learning Mandarin Chinese just so I could watch the movie and understand what they said. It was at that point that his life changed forever. His childhood drama was to go and live. His childhood dream was to go and live in the Shaolin Temple and learn Kung Fu and literature. Although T Lung was his inspiration, it was Bruce Lee that motivated him to learn Wing Chun Gung Fu. Right? Unfortunately, where he lived, there wasn't a Wing Chun school around. So he started learning martial arts at American Kempo Karate, right? Kempo Karate and kickboxing from Sensei Paul Huck School, and later began studying under Thomas Martin. Clark moved on to learning Taekwondo. Where did you learn Taekwondo? Where did you learn Taekwondo?
That's by
Master
Kim.
Master Kim. Yeah, it's not on here. Am I supposed to say Tai Chi? You learn Tai Chi, right? It's question and answer. It's question and answer. Tai Chi and many other styles along the way. But through it all, it was his goal to learn
Wing Chun.
There you go. Everybody knows Wing Chun is a woman's name, right?
Yep.
Woman's first name, right? I just learned it was her first name. Oh. I didn't know that. Oh. Right, Wing Chun. To know Wing Chun style, right? Not Wing Chun. A friend of his told him about a Wing Chun school in Orange County, so he was planning on checking it out. They both went, right? Both of you went? What was his name, your friend?
Nate.
Nate? Who was teaching Wing Chun?
Don
Flynn. Yeah. So they both went and enrolled immediately. Both of you?
Yeah.
Oh, very good. So his dream to study Wing Chun was finally realized. Clark Tang became an avid student of the art and studied it intently. He was awarded Sifu level and was told to pass on the art. He would then dedicate his life to Wing Chun and continue learning and teaching the art until today. Clark says, but I am still constantly learning all the time. Clark Tang opened his own school several years ago, January 1st, 2010. Right? 2010 in Long Beach. Nice. Anybody there? Are you guys there for the opening? No? Okay. Shame on you. No, just kidding. He struggled, though, with the name. He couldn't figure out what to call it. He was thinking that when he was a child, he always wanted to go to the Shaolin Temple to study martial arts and literature. Then a vision came to mind. Temple, then later, Wing Chun, right. So he came up with the name. Wing Chun Temple! Ah, very good. What year was it when you studied with Wong Long?
2013.
He studied with Sifu Grand Master Wong Long and was accepted as his disciple and his representative as the first chief instructor of the Wong Long Wing Chun Association and certified him as part of the lineage of Yip Man. Pretty cool.
Wow.
Nice.
Wow.
In 2014, the Martial Arts History Museum recognized Clark Tang for his excellence in the martial arts with the museum's honor award. Clark Tang has been a strong supporter of the museum and his efforts are greatly appreciated. Years from now, when people look back at the museum and have begun, Clark Tang's name will be there. Clark Tang would continue to promote Wing Chun by workshops, performances, and more. He has become one of the biggest advocates for promoting Wing Chun throughout the nation. He would also play a key role in bringing awareness to the American Shaolin Temple. Through the lineage of Yip Man through Grandmaster Wong Long, Clark Tang has been able to bridge a gap of understanding of the multiple benefits of Wing Chun and will continue to promote the art through his students, his example and his devotion to Kung Fu. This is Clark Tang.
Time becomes fast, never lightning. Although the future is a little bit frightening,
we said a lot of things about the martial arts life of Clark Tang. Let's shift our gears and talk about the non-martial arts life of Clark Tang. Did you know that Clark Tang is very, very patriotic? Did you know that? Yes, it's true. He doesn't have a fascination with politics or who's running for office. Now, he does have a fascination with the stars and stripes, the red, white, and the blue. Yes. It was around the mid-1970s when one day Clark flipped the channel on his TV set, and it was at that moment his life changed. The red, white, and blue. Yes, she wore blue bottoms with stars and stripes on it, on top. She wore a circle on her head, and she spun around, and she became Wonder Woman. That was it. It was right then that Clark has his first crush at the tender age of 6 years old. She was pretty cool, huh? Wonder Woman, yeah. Wonder Woman. Remember Wonder Woman? You guys remember Wonder Woman? You guys are too young for Wonder Woman, right? Remember Wonder Woman started? It was in the 1940s, and then the next season they decided to bump it up to the 70s or something like that. I don't know why they changed it. So it was a pretty good show. Clark was born in Cambodia. And when he was young, his family moved to the U.S. They ended up in Texas, moved to Cincinnati, Ohio, and then relocated to Long Beach, California, where he grew up most of his life. How old were you when you moved to Long Beach? 12? Ah, very good. He loves Long Beach because of the many different ethnicities, the small cities, and most of all, because Bruce Lee debuted at the Long Beach International Karate Championships. When?
1964.
four.
Whoa, you guys are good. Okay, you guys remember the karate championships, right? Okay, any of you guys remember the Long Beach Karate Championships? You remember going there?
Yes.
Remember? Okay, those of you who are new, this history lesson. Those of you new, okay. Tournaments started around the 1940s, late 1940s. What's his name? What's that guy's name who started it? Brought Kung Fu, brought karate to America. Trejo. No, it was
Trias.
Trias. So he started commercial schools, tried to throw little tournaments in here and there, and slowly it started to pick up as years went on. The 50s, slowly, it was the 60s that really started. Ed Parker decided to launch his first tournament called the Long Beach International Karate Champions. It was 1964, and it was going to be at the Long Beach Convention Center. The rents were probably low then. So he wanted to have some big stars come, you know, to kind of promote it. So Bruce Lee was one of them, Fumio Demura. Many people did demonstrations and all that. So it was there that Bruce Lee was introduced to the world. And 64, and then the year later, he was on the Green Hornet. Yeah, so that's where Bruce got his big, you know, debut was there. So everybody picked him up from there. So it was a great tournament. Lasted till what? In the 80s, after Mr. Parker died. Mr. Parker, when did Mr. Parker die? 1990. Mr. Parker died. The family kind of took it over for a few years, and then it kind of fizzled, you know, out. And then a couple of people tried to revive it. But back in its heyday, it was considered the biggest tournament there was. Now, it was Karate Illustrated, and all of them wanted to have, they were rating tournaments at the time. And they wanted to have, you know, you gotta be rated by us, and you gotta do this. And Ed Parker said, forget you, I don't need you. You know, I don't need Karate Illustrated. So he didn't care. He ran it in his own terms, and it became the biggest place everybody went, you know. The best of the best were there. The ring was so big, it would take an hour to walk around because everybody you knew was there. Cynthia Rothrock was there. You know, Chuck Norris was there. All those guys were there since 65, 67, 70, so an influx. So it became a huge event. So, but it was because of the new talent that he brought and Bruce Lee, you know, continually came here and there thereafter, but it was that talent that he brought out that made it so popular. So it was a big event. So that's your history lesson for the internationals. It's long gone. It fizzled away years ago. They've been trying to resurrect it for years, but, you know, the flavor is gone. It had its time. It had its time, and it was a blast. I went every year. We had a booth there, and everything was a blast. So everybody was there. Brendan Lai was there. You name it. They were all there, the best of the best. It lasted till 2 in the morning, till the black belts finished at 2 in the morning, day one. It was that many people. So anyway, Clark Tang's favorite TV show when he was a kid, anybody know? Favorite TV show was? Howdy Doody, right? Favorite TV show? Diver Dan, right?
Mr. Rogers?
No. Pokemon, right? There you go. SpongeBob SquarePants. No. It's Wonder Woman, of course. Clark said Wonder Woman is the ideal woman. A beauty with special powers and a good character. There she was. The very first movie that Clark Tang ever saw in the theater was when he snuck into the Chinese theater and saw the movie with Ti Lung. What was the name of the movie? The Duel. Nice. Very good. When he saw the Chinese Connection, it was during the graveyard scene in which Lee told his girlfriend, together we will be teaching Kung Fu for a living. And it was then that Clark made his decision to teach Kung Fu, right? You remember that scene? They're back to back, right?
Yeah,
that very romantic scene there. That's right, first time Bruce Lee ever kissed Lee. What did he want to be when growing up? He said since he was young, he always wanted to be a Kung Fu instructor like Bruce Lee in the Chinese Connection. His funniest birthday, the funnest birthday he ever had, it was just a year ago. his instructor Sifu Wong Long came and celebrated his birthday. And who used a supersonic punch to blow out the candle? Who did that? You or Long? Wong Long. You did. Supersonic punch. Nice. Very good. It goes like this. It was very special for him to come all the way from Hong Kong. He studied philosophy when he was a child. Philosophy? Like, example?
Western and Eastern
philosophy. Did you learn anything?
A little.
His favorite singing group when he was a kid, anybody?
Wing Chun.
Wing Chun? What? What is it? Anybody? Run DMC, Black Sabbath, and the Beastie Boys.
Wow.
Right? No, he's the Carpenter. Yeah! He really was the Carpenter. Yeah. I'm a Carpenter. The Carpenters are great Carpenters. Karen Carpenter. The greatest voice you ever heard. Yes. Karen Carpenter, right? Yes. Second only to Carole King. Yes.
Second only to Carole. Only just begun.
What a great voice she had. That was a great song. I still got the 45. I still got it. Anyone know what a 45? You guys know what a 45 is, right? You don't know what a 45. Okay, this is as bad as when we have tours of kids. I say, how many people know who Bruce Lee is? None of them raise their hand. And every tour that we have given, not a single kid, because, you know, 40 years ago, that's three generations from them. You know, they don't remember. So same thing, how many people, you know, remember the Carpenters? You know, how many even Carole King that I don't remember? Anyway, today he loves the Backstreet Boys, right? Backstreet Boys? And the Script? Is that a group? The Script? They used to call things you write on the script. Is that what they said? 98 degrees, like they were hot. You know, or plain white t-shirt, right? Plain white? What is it, plain white t-shirt? Do the kids know? You guys don't know. Plain white t-shirt? That's the name of Nine Inch Nails? That's the name of a group. Okay.